Professor Peter Singer is internationally known for his work on ethics, particularly relating to animals. Singer is a practical ethicist who has recently been revisiting the issue of animals used in scientific research as part of republishing his book, Animal Liberation, after more than 40 years. Professor Peter Singer, thank you for joining Cosmos. I note in your book, you write, it will not do to say never, and you don't take an absolutist position. But how do we go about drawing the line? Do you have a sense of how much research involving animals is actually about life-saving medicines?
Yeah, firstly, let me say that I have great respect for science too. I think it's really important to use scientific methods to try to work out the causes of major illnesses and the best ways to treat them. So I'm not at all anti-science. To answer your question, I do think that there's a very substantial proportion of the research that is done on animals that is not for urgent life-saving conditions and would not be justified if we were to consider the interests of the animals in a serious and significant way, as I think we should. They really take place because the animals become tools for research. The experimenter has no problem ordering another batch of a couple of hundred mice to do research on, but there has to be a reasonable expectation that something will achieve a significant benefit. And as we're saying, that benefit can't be achieved in any other way. So yes, I do accept in the book the possibility that some experiments can stand up to that test, even to give full weight to the interests of animals, but still be justified because of the very large number of people who will be benefited by it if it comes off. I think it's quite rare, and I don't think the system that we have of assessing experiments really is rigorous enough to allow only those sorts of experiments to pass. You know, I present evidence in the chapter of Animal Liberation Now on research that actually there's quite a low transfer rate from, say, experiments on mice to experiments on humans. In fact, I quote a former director of the United States National Institutes of Health, the largest source of government funding for health-related research, as saying, you know, we've made wonderful discoveries about curing cancer in mice, but they simply haven't translated to curing cancer in humans.
You talk about some of the types of experiments that are conducted on animals in your book. It's pretty grim reading, but it's maybe something people aren't really exposed to when they think about the use of animals in scientific research.
I'm particularly disturbed by some of the experiments that are deliberately causing stress to animals. In the book, I describe a whole chain of experiments which goes back to the 1950s, when experimenters were trying to cause some equivalent of depression in animals, a sort of animal model of depression, which, for example, involved producing something called learned helplessness, where animals were put in an enclosure that subjected them to inescapable electric shock, which at first, of course, they resisted and tried to escape. But eventually, since they couldn't escape, they gave up and they lay on the floor of the enclosure, passively accepting electric shocks. And that was supposed to be some model of depression. Well, it never produced anything useful for treating human depression. And it's not really that surprising that this condition isn't all that like depression. The chain of experiments on specifically on depression came to a stop. But instead, scientists adapted some of these methods to try to research post-traumatic stress disorder. And obviously, there are some parallels of they saw between what they were doing to the animals to cause depression and what they're doing to cause stress, because you have to cause traumatic stress if you're going to produce an animal model of post-traumatic stress disorder. Indeed, the experiments do that in various ways, sometimes with electric shock, sometimes putting animals, say, again, mice or rats, into a vertical-sided container filled with water or partly filled with water in which they have no escape. They're dropped into the water and they have to keep swimming. And so that's obviously stressful because they know, they may swim for a very long time in order to try to stay alive, but they really can't get out. Again, there's no real parallel here with PTSD in humans. We respond in many different ways. We have very different social relationships. We obviously talk to people about our condition, which these animals don't do. It's really hard to see the value of these experiments, although they're clearly very, very distressing to the animal, and but they have to be. That's the purpose of doing these things to the animal.
The CSIRO in Australia recently released a strategy for moving towards non-animal models in medical product development. Obviously, the shift away from using animals in research, there are likely to be gains for science and certainly for the animals themselves. Are there any vested interests likely to lose out in that transition away from using animals in research?
Absolutely. There are in a way two different kinds of vested interests. One is the scientists who've been trained to do work with animals and don't really know any other way of doing things. I suppose that will simply become a generational shift. The younger generation will look at different ways of doing things, and eventually the older generation will retire. But the larger financial interest, and that's perhaps particularly in the United States, is the very large companies that are supplying animals for laboratories. Charles River Breeding Laboratories is one of the world's largest, perhaps the world's largest, and it funds lobbyists in US Congress and organizations that address the public and try to persuade them of the urgent necessity for doing animal research. But yeah, there's certainly vested interests. Just last month, I was at a conference in Canada, the 12th World Congress on Alternatives to Animals in Research. There were over 800 participants at that Congress from 40 different countries. A lot of them were scientists and people working in the development of alternatives. And I was very impressed by the amount of work going on in a whole range of different ways of replacing animals, from developing cell cultures to the use of AI to screen out substances that would be harmful to humans. So it is a rapidly growing field. There were quite a number of people from Europe where a lot of this work was going on. I think that's encouraging. And certainly Australia needs to at least be up there with the leading pack. But if CSIRO says we're lagging behind, then I do think we need to make more of an effort.